And from that, let's turn to the analysis of Shields and Brooks. That is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. So, gentlemen, Mark, let's just talk about this right now. What do you see this energy or this emotion and anger? What does it mean coming at these Republican town halls?
Well, first of all, a shout out for Congressman Lance. For doing it, and for a thoughtful interview with Lisa, for having another town meeting, because several of his colleagues have tucked tail and run and ducked it. So the energy, Judy, is real. There's no doubt about it. But I think Ross Baker put the point well, the political philosopher and teacher, when he said it isn't as focused. I mean, it's quite diffuse. There are those who want to impeach Donald Trump. Donald Trump, I hate to tell people who are concerned about it, is not going to be impeached. American people believe in giving somebody a fair chance. He's a new president. There have been troubles. There have been problems. And the stock market just set 10 days in a row of new records, whether because of him or in spite of him. But the energy is real, and the question is, can it be focused, can it be disciplined, can it be sustained?
How do you answer all those questions?
First, I think Donald Trump is not going to be impeached this month. Let's not close out possibilities. I would say a couple things. I do think that what's happening is great, and that people are active and people are just involved in the democratic process. The Tea Party thing is only apt in some ways. The activism in the town halls, that looks superficially like it. But what the Tea Party did was they went after the party, the Republican Party, as their vehicle. And parties is how you change history. So it's fine to be an activist, but if you're not putting up candidates, if you're not getting political, if you're not in your party, then you're probably not going to have long-term change. You'll probably dissipate. And then it's tempting to remember that the Tea Party had a peak, mm-hmm. and then the Republican establishment sort of beat it back down. And so these things aren't one in a day. And then the final thing the Tea Party had was they fed into the philosophy that Donald Trump now embodies. So they had a different view of how the world should be governed. And so they had a lot of things that we didn't appreciate going for them as time went by.
So it did lead to something, Mark. I mean,
it certainly did. It led to the Republican takeover of 2010. And Kevin McCarthy, who's now the House Majority Leader, was pretty open. He went out and recruited candidates who had emerged from that movement. And the Republicans in the House have paid a price for it ever since, because they cannot pass anything comprehensive or real because of the Freedom Caucus, which is the child, the product, the progeny of the Tea Party.
Right. But to both of you, just quickly, you're hearing some Republicans, you're hearing the White House saying, "Well, a lot of this is orchestrated. It's been somebody sitting there, sort of pulling the strings."
Yeah.
How genuine is this?
It's genuine, Judy. The argument of those who are being criticized at any time, the civil rights movement forward, the anti-war movement forward, is it's always outside agitators doing it. The Wall Street Journal had a pretty good piece yesterday that this is organic. It's not organic. Organized. It's real. Are there people nationally working on it? Sure. But the people who are emerging from those districts, I mean, when Tom Cotton hears a woman stand up in Arkansas and said, three members of my family would be dead but for ACA, including me. Where do you get your insurance, Senator? They're all going to be asked that. So it's genuine.
There's nothing wrong with being organized. I mean, you know, things that change history tend to be organized. And so I do think what the Tea Party also had was Obamacare and the unpopularity of that, at least at the time. And so whether there's something that's equally unpopular and equally galvanizing that is almost self-destructive from the administration, that's another factor that we'll wait and see.
We'll wait and see about that. But meantime, right now, and we talked about it a few minutes ago on the show, Mark, the Democrats are about to choose a new party chair. We were talking about the message of the party. Do you hear a clear message coming from the Democrats? Do you think it matters whether they come together around any message right now?
Sure, it will, Judy. But I don't hear any clear, coherent message. I mean, when your party out of power, it's the time to be a national party chair. When the party holds the White House, all the political decisions are made in the White House. And being a party chair, you're just an artifact. But being a party chair, you really have a chance to make a difference. But what the Democrats have to do is recognize and accept the fact that they're their lowest point since 1928 in the United States House of Representatives, and their lowest point since 1925 in states. So, I mean, they've got to start winning elections. That involves not a great idea, but it also involves recruiting candidates. And Rahm Emanuel, the mayor of Chicago, who was given obnoxiousness a new definition in his personal behavior, oftentimes in his dealings with the press, had a very good point, and that is the Democrats have to do what he did when he was chairman of the Democratic House Campaign Committee, recruit veterans, recruit football players, recruit business people. And I think that's what the job of the new party chair has to be.
Yeah, I guess to me the fundamental thing, well, I guess I see a lot of people debating this in the wrong way. A lot of the debate is, should we go to the coast, should we go to the center, should we go to the left, should we go to the right? But Trump is instructive here, actually. You figure out what is the crucial issue facing the country right now. And for Trump, it was that the global economy and the international world order were failing regular people. And so he said, that's the crucial issue, I'm going to take a clear stand on that issue. And he did, and it's very internally consistent, and he won with it. For the Democrats, they're trying to avoid having the Sanders-Clinton debate over and over again, mm-hmm. but to some degree, they're sentenced to that debate. Clinton is much more embracing of the global economy and the international world over. Sanders and Warren are much less so, and they got to figure out which side the party is on if they're going to have a clear message. I think this is probably when you probably can't straddle.
So when you hear, as we heard earlier, when they say, well, opportunity for all, you're saying it's got to be more specific.
Franklin Roosevelt had a pretty clear line. Ronald Reagan had a pretty clear line. People who rescue parties. And it doesn't have to be the same line that we've had for the last 40 years, because that clearly isn't working on any level. But you got to have a pretty clear line on this crucial issue. Is the global capitalism basically to be supported or is it to be opposed? Is the international world order to be supported or is it to be opposed? Republicans have taken a very clear line. Democrats can have a different version of that line, or they can go say, no, we're the party of international peace and activism, and we're the party that's going to have a civilized capitalism.
2 points. First of all, that's way above the job description and job definition of a party chair. That will be fought out in the primaries in 2020, before that in 2018 as well. But Franklin Roosevelt also ran on a balanced budget in 1932. And the greatest president certainly right. of the 20th century. So the idea that you've laid out a predicate right now, Donald Trump has recreated the Republican Party in his image. We saw that at the CPAC convention, Judy. That was a total surrender of the Reagan era. Ronald Reagan is gone. I mean, he is nothing
wow.
but a distant memory.
Gone?
Well, seeing that party together, I mean, he stood up there and he said, you finally have a president. You finally have a president. I am the future. And what did he get? Hosannas and huzzas and genuflection. I mean, it was a total takeover of the conservative movement. That's what the conservative movement has become, is basically an annex of the Trump campaign.
Yeah, I disagree.
You think the two are now one, that it's the Trump it's, and the conservative?
I don't
conservative.
Know if it'll be forever for this moment. Yeah, for sure. I mean, Steve Bannon went to the CPAC this week,
yes.
and he said that there was a very important historical turning point, right. Getting rid of the trade, TPP. Mm-hmm. And, like, the Republican Party has stood for that for as long as I've been alive. And then Trump, today, he, buy American, anti-free trade, and got big cheers. They're waving Russian flags. It probably partly is a joke. But still, the party has become an ethnic nationalist party. And I don't think it's just because that we agree with Trump on some things and not on others. I do think over the last 10 years, a lot of Republicans have decided it's not working, what the party believed in, the free trade, global capitalism, open borders. They looked at basically the failed wars, and they said, this us being the policemen of the world, that's not working. And so something really serious has shifted in the minds of Republicans and certainly others.
But aren't there still Republicans who say CPAC doesn't represent me, that I'm not part of the conservative movement? I'm a Republican, but I'm not there.
Absolutely. I mean, this is a group, don't forget, that gave its presidential straw ballots to Ron Paul, and Rand Paul. So they've abandoned what were their libertarian values and instincts to embrace Trump. I mean, Judy, there is gone is any mention of American exceptionalism. I mean, I happen to believe that three times in the 20th century, the United States saved Western democracy, both World Wars and the Cold War.
Well, you're hearing about America first.
But America's exceptionalism, American leadership, The American model, the American values are not, I mean, they're something that end at the border. There's something that are just for us, and American responsibility there's no mention of it.
We had the clip early in the program of Trump saying, "I'm not president of the globe, I'm president of the United States." Yeah. Reagan would have never said that. Eisenhower would have never said that because he would have said, "Yes, I'm president of the United States, but it's in our interest to be securing a world order."
A citizen of the world.
And that is the two are so intricately linked. But Trump sees an opposition between the two. It's a very different mindset. The other thing that's changed, this is more detail to CPAC than the general Republican Party, is they've always been an outsider, Ann Coulter, sort of protest style, a little ruder than most Republicans, and this goes back all the way to Reagan. Lee Atwater, Reagan's strategist, had no patience for CPAC because he thought they were sort of wild and immature, basically. Mm-hmm. And so that's always been a strain. So it's interesting how identity politics and Ann Coulter-style tactics have now blossomed, but they were always there in CPAC.
Okay, just about a minute and a half left. I want to quickly ask you, we're careful about how we talk about President Trump and the news media, because we think you can quickly get into a situation, Mark, where you're looking at yourself and being a little too self-referential, any of us in the news media. But what I want to ask both of you quickly is this something that the press, is going to begin to define the press, the president's constant daily saying fake news, the press is dishonest, the press makes things up?
Well, Judy, he's moved from the enemy being Barack Obama, now gone fading as Hillary Clinton, and there's no question he's chosen the enemy. I thought what Steve Bannon said yesterday was probably more chilling or more threatening than anything the president says. I mean, because he said it's a constant day. We have to defeat the press. And President Kennedy, after the Bay of Pigs, said to Turner Catledge of the New York Times, "I wish you'd written more. I wish you'd investigated more, because it might have saved the country the cataclysm of the Bay of Pigs." That's the job of a free press, is to hold the lamp up, to investigate, to hold accountable. Denying access, as Sean Spicer did today, is the first step toward a dictatorship.
Yeah. I mean, it's both strategic to get people's minds off other things and to pick an internal enemy. It's part of his psychodynamics to always care about his press coverage intensely. He's more interested in that than anything else. Will it stick? Of course, I tend to think not, the fake media, but I'm sure little Marco didn't think it would stick. I'm sure crooked Hillary didn't think it would stick. These labels do have a certain power to them, and so we'll see how it plays out.
We will see. David Brooks, Mark Shields, thank you both.
Thank you, Judy.